I am the Zach Monson. Welcome back to a very special edition of Pause Play here at Canadian Music Week, where I talk to Royal Wood about his new album Ghostlight, his musical beginnings, and drinking a nice glass of wine. Check it out right now. Royal Wood, thank you so much for coming on the show, my friend. How you doing?
I'm doing very well, thank you.
You did a great show at the NAC last night. How'd that go?
Fantastic. Dream show. Yeah, I was in Southam Hall with the full symphony orchestra and my band and singers. And yeah, it's what, you know, it's what you live for.
Yeah. You know, you started playing piano at kind of 4 years old, I think, something like that.
I started playing music really young. A lot of instruments when I was pretty young.
How do you remember the first time music kind of came into your life? The first time you played piano? The first time you picked up a guitar?
No, I just don't remember a time when I wasn't doing it. You know, there's kids that grab a hockey stick, and my brothers were big into sports and stuff, and I just wanted to play music when I was a kid.
And when was that point where it went from, I just like playing guitar, to I want to write songs, I want to be a musician, this is the path I want to take in my life?
Again, I don't have a moment of deciding otherwise. It was just, it was the thing that made me most excited about the day, you know, and especially when you have three older brothers, you just kind of lock yourself in a room and find your own solace, and music was solace.
Was there a plan B?
No.
No.
No, there was no plan B. I mean, I dropped out of school, and I headed to Toronto, and this was it. This is what I wanted to do.
The new album is Ghostlight. It's wonderful. And if you listen to your older works, they're quite soft and not more tame, but this album seems to have a little more body, a little more soul, a little more backbone to it.
Yeah, well, there's just a lot more energy, and I think that's just come in life from shedding layers and being more mature and just expressing myself with how I am right now, you know? And when I was a kid, I was really quiet and reserved and shy, and as a result, I think my earlier stuff was pretty pulled back and somber, but I'm not a somber guy.
You're not a somber guy?
No.
No, that's good to know.
Yeah.
You have a new... we'll call it a YouTube show, where you drink wine and play music. I can probably guess how it started, but tell me how that started for you.
That was exactly that. Yeah, I mean, I love wine, and I've studied it at George Brown on sort of off days and third level.
But you were on track to be a sommelier.
Yeah, just it's for purely part-time. You're on a tour bus, you're on an airplane, and you get to do something other than just think about music. So started studying wine textbooks. But... basically, yeah, people kept asking me to do some covers, and it's never been a part of my repertoire. I've never really performed them live and never wanted to record them. And I was drinking a bottle of wine, and I was like,
as we do,
you know what? Tonight's the night. And it gave birth to the Uncorked cover sessions.
I think it's wonderful.
Yeah, it's good. It's a lot of fun.
Do you have any good wine tips for people trying to get into the whole wine world, starting to drink wine? A good tip.
A good tip? No, the tip is just to drink it.
Okay. Wow, I probably could have thought of that tip myself, actually.
Well, if you're going to appreciate something, you have to experience it and just get a little bit of knowledge. Even a tiny bit of knowledge will change your navigation in the liquor store.
And what wine do you love right now?
Oh, I love all wine, as long as it's well-made. Red, white, rosé,
You're one of those sommeliers who's not really picky. As long as it gives you a buzz, you'll drink it.
No,
if it's made of grapes and it's been sitting around for a while, you'll drink it.
It's not, truthfully, it's not the buzz. It's the flavor profile, and if it goes with what I'm eating and... if that happens, it's like when people get fascinated by coffee, and you will go to any length possible to have a good cup of coffee and not buy Tim Hortons or Starbucks on the road. Us as musicians, we're on the road. You have guys who will get up 40 minutes earlier for lobby call because they're like, I got to go find that real cup of coffee.
The right cup of coffee, yeah. I get it. Going back to Ghostlight for a second, is there a song on the album that means the most to you, that is closest to your heart?
No, they're all my children. They're all my babies.
All
yeah,
parents I didn't drown. Always have a favorite kid. They just don't say it.
No, but I wouldn't. I'd love all my children equally. No, they're all unique forms and beings, and they all had to live, you know? And there's lots of miscarriages, and there's lots of ones that didn't make it, but they're not on the album, so.
How many songs do you think you wrote with the intent of putting them on this album that didn't make it? And how do you choose, what's your process like saying, this one's a good fit and this one is not?
Well, my intention wasn't even to be making a record this time. My intention was to just be in Los Angeles taking some time off.
Right.
And
which never
enough,
happens.
It never happens. No, I was in a studio and I was doing some writing for some other people and had a few days and was like, I'm going to play some songs for my friend Bill Leffler, who's a producer down there. And he loved them, so we're like, oh, let's just do one song today. And I just jumped around from instrument to instrument. And then by day three, we had three songs.
Right.
And we really looked at each other like, I think maybe we should just keep this going.
Yeah.
But as songwriters, and I know this is true for most of us, we always have a bunch of songs kicking around because you're always making something. And just eventually, you end up making an album.
I mean, you said it before I could say it, but you kind of jumped from one instrument to another. You've played the majority of the instruments on the album.
Yeah.
Why the choice to do that?
Just, it was just an organic process. I mean, again, I wasn't planning on making a record, you know, there wasn't pre-production, there wasn't rehearsals, there wasn't a budget. It was just me and this guy, Bill, who's just this incredible producer and has the studio down in LA, and we made my last record together, and him and I have made a few records for some Canadian artists, and it just kind of happened, you know, it was necessity, and I was in the room, and I could play all these things, and we were just having fun, really.
It really is a beautiful collection of songs. Each song is lovely in its own right, but as a collection of music, it really is, it's wonderful.
Oh, thanks very much. Thanks.
So we had the last artist in to ask you a question.
Okay.
The band is Foreign Diplomats, and their question for you is...
Hey, we're Foreign Diplomats, and my question for you is, do you want to change bass players with us? He's there.
Tony,
that one.
On the bass.
I'm going to have to say no.
Okay, and why not?
And not any slight towards them. Because my bass player's been playing with me since 2006, and he's my best friend in the world, and he was at my wedding, and he probably helped me sign my divorce papers. So he's been a part of my life
so
for a decade.
Okay, so he's been around for all the stuff.
He's been around for a long time, and so he's not going anywhere.
Okay.
But my drummer, maybe.
No one likes a drummer. It's fine. They're replaceable. Who are some artists that you think people should go and check out?
Go and check out? I would say the record I'm most excited by is my friend Hannah Georges. And her record's coming out
soon.
She
is so good.
She's ridiculously talented. And she's one of those on the front of the wave, you know? She is the trend and not chasing it.
Yeah.
So I expect Hannah to blow up this year, really and truly. I hope she's ready for it, but that's what's happening.
It's kind of been a slow uprise for her. I've never understood why it hasn't been more of a quicker incline, but...
Yeah, because the rest of us know what's there. Right. You know, we all see it. So I've seen her grow up so much so fast, and musically and artistically, and I feel like this is now...
Her time.
Her time. This is definitely Hannah's time. So that's the record I'm most excited about.
Do you have a song that you can't stop listening to right now?
No. No.
Just a whole bunch of music.
It's just a whole bunch of music. You know, we're obviously surrounded by music, and we hear so much as artists, and whenever we're touring, someone's always, gotta hear this. So my mind right now is so focused on the tour that we're on that I'm kind of self-involved.
Yeah, I understand that. What do you think the best part about being a Canadian musician is?
Best part of being a Canadian musician? It's the same thing that makes us great to be a Canadian. We live in a...
Beaver tails, is that?
Yeah, beaver tails. That's what it's all about, beaver tails in Ottawa.
Yeah.
No, it's we're able to make music and freedom of speech and do what we want in this country and say what we want to say. And there's so many artists in other countries that don't get to do what we do in Canada. And let's be honest, it's a country that is a patron of the arts. I mean, this entire
Absolutely.
Music industry would crumble if there wasn't governmental funding going into every label that's a part of this entire conference. Like, we are a very fortunate country.
We're a very fortunate country.
Yeah.
You gonna play some music for us?
Yeah, I'll play some music for you.
Yeah, we'll play some songs. Thank you so much for coming by, my friend.
My pleasure, thank you.
You can hear Royal Wood on Stingray Music's Adult Alternative Channel, Canadian Indie Channel, and the Pop Adult Channel. We like you.
Thanks.
See you guys next time.